inescapable feature of life in Romania under Nicolae Ceausescu was the ubiquity of the Securitate, or the secret police, known officially for much of the period as the Department of State Security. I realized as much from my first contact with the country in 1965, but was not surprised to discover, after the downfall of Ceausescu, that my professional and personal involvement with Romania, which encompassed the entire duration of his rule from 65 to 89, should attract the Securitate's attention. My professional association with the country was cemented by my appointment as assistant lecturer in Romanian language and literature at SSEES on the 1st of October 1969, after having completed a 9-month British Council bursary in Bucharest, during which time I gathered material for my PhD, a textual and linguistic study of a 17th century Romanian manuscript. In January 2006, a revision in Romania of the law on access to the archive of the Securitate enabled non-Romanian citizens to apply to consult their personal files. I did so in the following month. Six volumes were produced, three containing paper copies of materials compiled by various sections of the Directorate of Internal Security, and a further three microfilmed by the current intelligence service from original reports drawn up by the foreign intelligence units of the Securitate and photocopied by the CNSAS, that is, the National Council for the Study of the Securitate Archive. They total some 1,500 pages and cover the year 65 to 89. While there are no photographs of me in my own file, I am occasionally caught on camera in the company of my tutor at SSEES, Eric Tappy, at the entrance of various apartment blocks in Bucharest where we had common friends, as my consultation of his file reveals. Both Eric and I shared the accolade of being, in the Securitate's jargon, agents of British intelligence, since we were both on the staff of SSEES, which itself was categorized in our respective files as an agency of British espionage. As with other machines of political oppression, the Securitate's most potent weapon was fear, and the depth of its inculcation into the Romanian population provided the principal reasons for its success. Fear induces compliance and is therefore a tremendous labor-saving device. The Securitate's numbers were far smaller than popular myth would have us believe. Records indicate that in 1950, that is 2 years after its creation, the number of personnel of all ranks totaled almost 5,000. By December 89, this number had risen to some 15,300. The contents of my file range from photocopies of my correspondence with my Romanian wife's family and Romanian friends — this constitutes an entire volume of some 400 pages — and analyses by Securitate officers of my activity both at SSEES and in Romania. They include accounts by informers of my movements, comments by me on the economic situation in Romania, and transcripts of conversations recorded by eavesdropping, mostly wiretaps. My friends included creative writers, historians, engineers, doctors, peasant farmers, party officials, students, pensioners, Hungarians, Saxons, and Jews. Most were figures of light, a handful of darkness. I was amused to find that I was given several code names during the period of my surveillance by the various Securitate units. MacDonald was one, mystified but flattered to be considered Scottish. David, Dante, Dima, Croitoru in Romanian meaning tailor, and Aurul in Romanian gold. This diversity of code names is the result of independent assignment of them by provincial offices of the Securitate in towns where my movements were followed. Consultation of my file made me aware of an extraordinary expenditure of time, money, and effort on the part of the Securitate. The need for conspirativity, or conspirativitate in Romanian, required compartmentation that kept each officer's activity and his or her informers a secret, both from colleagues as well as from the public. But such compartmentation led to duplication of officers' efforts and inefficiency. The Securitate used surveillance as a means of discovering with whom I came into contact. As a result, some of my friends were, in inverted commas, persuaded to become informants. In the case of the most prolific informer in my file for the years 69 to 1973, a young teacher of Saxon background, the viewer of a passport of emigration to West Germany to join relatives established there was the inducement. After the revival of a provision of Gheorghe Udej, that was Ceausescu's predecessor, introduced in 1958 and revived under Decree No. 408 of December 85, failure to report a conversation with a foreign citizen was deemed a criminal offence, and this measure was used to pressurise persons into informing. Officers were also instructed to appeal to patriotic sentiment as a ploy, but could also use blackmail in exceptional circumstances. These are the words actually used in the Securitate handbook for using informers. So blackmail, exceptional circumstances. In fact, many informers were trapped in this way when presented with evidence of their own malpractice at work or sexual indiscretion. Some of the Romanian lectors assigned to SSEES by the British Council under the terms of the British-Romanian Culture Agreements to assist with the teaching of the Romanian language and literature between 64 and 88 also reported back to Bucharest on my work in SSEES and more broadly on my wider activities, knowledge of which they were able to gain since my wife and I always made an effort to show hospitality to them during their stay in the UK. Most of these reports were benign, a handful vexatious. During the research I conducted after 89 into the Securitate, I was given a confidential document of the Ministry of Internal Affairs, dated 87, which showed that it was a condition of appointment that lecturers agreed to provide information not only on their experience at the host institution, but also on other Romanians resident in the UK, should they be asked to do so by the relevant authorities. I am not suggesting that all the lectors did this, but merely wish to point out the degree of intrusion of the Securitate into such teachers' duties. As a student of Romance languages at SSEES and UCL, Romanian at SSEES and Latin at UCL, I made my first visit to Romania in July 65, to attend a Romanian language summer school under the auspices of the British Council. I was quartered, along with some 80 other students from various countries, in a former army barracks, provisionally or previously used by units of the Red Army, at the summer school centre in Sinaia. This mountain resort is situated some 150 kilometres north of Bucharest, and access to the barracks and to the former gambling casino, used as a lecture theatre, was allowed only to authorised persons. On the Romanian side, these were officials of the Ministry of Education, our Romanian language teachers, and group leaders who were assigned to contingents of students by language. Thus, the American and British students were entrusted to the care of an English-speaking journalist from the Communist Party daily Scânteia, who was responsible for making sure that we did not stray from the school compound. Members of the public were kept out by armed guards in civilian clothes who carried shotguns and who regularly patrolled the access points to the school area, which in addition to the barracks and the casino, included the adjacent former royal castle of Pelishor. My natural curiosity, fortified by my rudimentary knowledge of Romanian, which I had been studying for 6 months at SSEES under the tutelage of Eric Tappy, and which I was anxious to practice with a native speaker, drove me to engage one of the guards in conversation. He wore what I came later to recognize as virtually regulation dress for a security policeman, a black leather jacket and black knee-length leather coat in inclement weather. Asked why he carried a shotgun so ostensibly, he replied that it was to deter anyone from disturbing our privacy, since we students were guests of the Romanian government. I told him that one of my reasons for coming to the school was in the hope of being able to meet Romanians of my own age, and that under such conditions of security it was impossible to do so. He smiled and said that there were still fascist elements around in the country whose aim was to spread damaging propaganda about what he called Romanian realities, and that therefore it would be more instructive for me to stay in the summer school compound rather than venture out. Undeterred, on the second Sunday of our course, excursions were arranged on Sundays to nearby places of historical and cultural interest. I took advantage of the affability of our group leader to ask him whether I could not go down into the town of Sinaia to visit a bookshop and buy some contemporary Romanian novels. My request clearly struck a melodious chord with him, and he proceeded to recommend a handful of authors. He had, however, to consult with the course supervisors for an answer. It came back positive, and I therefore ventured alone into the town. Passing the guard at the entrance to the complex, the latter advised me to return by 6 p.m. In Sinaia, I was immediately intrigued by the fact that people of all ages stared at my clothes, and in particular at my shoes. The latter, I learned, were the conclusive hallmark of a Westerner, since Romanian items of clothing were uniform. They were stas, or state standard product. Only on one occasion did a trio of young Romanians in Sinaia ask me where I was from. On hearing that I was British, they invited me for a coffee. I was led to a log cabin in the woods, from where, as we approached, appropriately, I caught the strains of the Beatles' Norwegian Wood. Inside, it was crammed with teenagers in animated conversation against the background of music from a jukebox. Successive songs were from an album by the same band, and my friends eagerly asked me to complement their fragmentary understanding of the lyrics. This I did, adding translations where necessary in my faltering Romanian. Eventually, feeling that they were in my debt, I inquired why no ordinary Romanians came up to the summer school complex. They laughed, looked around, and invited me to walk with them. "You see," one of them said, "we live in a socialist country, and here the state maps out your life for you from birth. You are assigned a school, you are assigned a job, and you are assigned a place to live. Conformity is the rule. You do what you are told, and meeting foreigners is off limits. If your expectations are low and you don't step out of line, then you will be satisfied. And to make sure that you don't step out of line, they have the Securitate." That was the first and only mention of the secret police during my carefully stage-managed stay. But, taken together with my observations in the town, was enough to puncture the bubble of socialist achievement with which the practical classes in the Romanian language and the lectures on Romanian history and literature were inflated. The brief encounter with the trio and the reference to "they have the Securitate" showed that while the uniformity of clothing might be interpreted as a symbol of that conformity which the communist regime had sought to impose upon the people, there were some who saw the authorities as alien and who did not share their values. It was only when I read a report dated February 66 from my file that I became aware that I had attracted then the attention of the Securitate. It was a background check made at the request of the Securitate to their Brasov office in Transylvania on two teenage Romanian girls whom I had met the previous July, that is in 65, during one of the summer school Sunday excursions. The girls were members of a folk dance troupe who had performed for us in the village of Sirliște, close to Brașov. At their request, we became pen pals, but such contact had clearly aroused suspicion. The background check revealed nothing suspicious, or potentially so, and so the resolution on the report was that no action was to be taken against the girls or their parents. It was only in January 1969, when I took up a 9 months postgraduate scholarship awarded by the British Council, that I was able to travel in the country unescorted, although not unshadowed, as my file revealed. In most of the bars and coffee houses frequented by students, there was the resident eavesdropper, who placed himself at a corner table with a stockings trade newspaper. More than 50 pages of my file are devoted to my friendship, engagement, and marriage to Andrea. Association with a Romanian girl by an outsider was tolerated by the authorities, and although my father-in-law, a university professor, and some of his neighbors revealed to me that they were regularly asked by Securitate officers about my movements, no attempt was ever made to discourage me. From my fiancée and her parents, I learnt about one family suffering under communist rule, an experience that was typical of most people of their background. My father-in-law's father, Dumitru Calacostea, the first holder in the 1920s of a chair in Romanian literature at the University of Bucharest, had been arrested in Bucharest at the age of 71 in May 1950 as one of a group of former ministers from the pre-communist period. The experience of a labor camp under Gheorghiu Dej and the brutish Securitate officers and guards gave my father-in-law confidence in preparing me for tackling the labyrinthine processes of the Ministry of the Interior. For it was upon this ministry's goodwill that my wife Andrea, or my future wife Andrea's chances of a future depended. For marriage to a foreigner, a Romanian citizen required the signature of Nicolae Ceausescu himself as head of this Council of State. In a country where the abnormal was normal, I was foolish to harbour the belief that once married, my bride would be automatically given a passport to accompany me to Britain. Having obtained an application form from the passport office at the beginning of January 73, Andrea found that the officer on duty refused to accept the completed document from her. My father-in-law then advised me to write a memorandum to the commandant of the office, stating who I was and why my wife needed a passport, and to hand it in and obtain a receipt. He helped me to compose the text, which mentioned that I was often asked to lecture to British audiences about Romania, and that if my wife was not granted a passport, my disappointment would inevitably be reflected in my presentation. Andrea, given her experiences at the hands of the Securitate, was too nervous to accompany me to the passport office, and so I went alone, blustering my way past the armed sentry by claiming to be from the British Embassy and requesting to see the commandant. I was directed to a side room full of stone-faced Romanians seated on wooden benches. On the walls were pinned posters in stark black lettering warning of the penalties for those attempting to cross the frontier without a passport. And below them, to ram home the message, mug shots of those who had been caught doing so. A caption beneath carried the prison sentences they had received, usually 2 years. After about half an hour, during which not a word was uttered, a short, portly, balding major came out of the office marked commandant and proceeded to ask each person in turn his business. Using the familiar and condescending form of you, he dismissed every applicant curtly, ordering them to come back at another date. He turned to me last of all, once the others had gone. I drew myself to my full height, which was some inches above him, and when he addressed me with a surly, "What's your business then?" I replied that I was from the British Embassy and that I had a memorandum to deposit in support of my wife's request for a passport. I proffered the envelope, but he did not even look at it, instead saying that he could not receive it. I insisted that unless it was received, I would take the matter up elsewhere. This seemed to shake him, and he took the memorandum. He went into the office, marked commandant, and 5 minutes later came out with the instruction that I should return with my wife at 6 o'clock the following morning, not following evening, following morning. At the appointed time, in a sub-zero temperature, Andrea and I went back. Apart from the sentry at the door of the building, there was no other sign of life. We went gingerly into the side room. After a few minutes, the major appeared and ushered us into the commandant's office. He then withdrew. The only light in the room came from a powerful table lamp, which was directed on 2 chairs in front of a desk. Behind the desk, we could make out a man in his early 50s, in a dark suit, dark tie, and dark glasses. He invited us to sit down, and then demonstratively pored over what we presumed to be my memorandum. Without acknowledging my presence at all, he told my wife to go to room 15 in the adjacent building where she could collect her passport. Andrea said a word of thanks, and in a couple of minutes the meeting was over. This progress seemed too good to be believed, and indeed it was. When we got to room 15, we were invited in by a dour-looking woman of about 50 with graying hair swept back into a bun. She had obviously been forewarned of our arrival, for she handed to my wife a single sheet of paper with a list of documents, which she had to submit in order to be issued a passport. "These are the papers you must obtain. There are 35 of them, all affidavits stating that you have no debts to any state agencies, such as the gas company, the electricity board, the rent office, etc. For each affidavit, you will have to make an application to the relevant agency authorised by the state notary." Our hearts sank when we realised the bureaucratic hill we now had to climb. It is here that the extended family really came into its own in surmounting the obstacle placed in our path by the state. Aunts and uncles, cousins and friends who had contacts in each of the institutions and agencies from which we required an affidavit, all sprang into action. We gave a notary a generous supply of foreign cigarettes, and she assiduously typed up and authorized the necessary applications. Within 3 days, we managed to obtain all 35 documents, and on a Sunday morning, we returned triumphantly to the lady in room 15. She congratulated us on our diligence, but then, looking down the list, heaved a sigh of regret. "I am so sorry. There is one document you require which is not on this list. Our face is dropped. Is it that important? Is it really necessary?" we asked in unison. "I'm afraid that it is. It is an affidavit from the university stating that you have no training shoes borrowed from the university gym." "But I have never been to the gym," Andrea protested. "I'm sorry," came the reply, "but I still need the paper." I was certain that this was merely her way of asserting her importance by inventing a pretext for making us dependent upon her goodwill. My wife might be travelling to the West, but before she did so, she would have to yield to the authority of this ageing woman, who, because of her position in the ministry, was herself denied the possibility of foreign travel. Envy was translated into a need to demonstrate power, and it was this sentiment that fueled many of the conflicts which I was to have later with individuals within the Romanian bureaucracy. Andrea and I dashed off to the university, where a sympathetic dean of studies expressed amazement at our request and duly produced the requisite piece of paper. Within an hour, we were back at the passport office. In a final act of theatrical suspense, our spinsterish taskmistress leafed through a filing cabinet full of passports and declared that my wife was not there. I then had the presence of spirit to say, "I'm sure that a ministry such as your own, which is celebrated for its efficiency, could not possibly have mislaid a passport." She turned to me and smiled. "I can see, comrade," she corrected herself, "Mr. Deletant, that you have learned a lot in our country." She went over to her desk, opened a drawer, and handed my wife her passport. Andrea was so overcome with emotion that she gave the startled woman a peck on both cheeks. And I, after kissing her hand, led my wife from the room. In the corridor outside, we discovered that the exit visa in the passport was valid only for departure by air. I had travelled to Romania in my Austin minivan. We went back in and pointed this out, to which she replied, "You will have to come back on Monday to have it changed. Today is only a half day. Here's the name of the officer you must see." At 7 a.m. on the Monday, we inquired after the officer, a major, responsible for exit visas. He was most understanding when we explained that we intended to leave the country by car, and within the quarter of an hour had added the frontier point of Stamara Moravica on the border with Yugoslavia. He wrote on the visa the number of my car, and that very morning we set off, before, as Andrea feared, the authorities could put another obstacle in our path. We drove all day and reached the frontier at 11 p.m. on 15th of January. The post was deserted, except for a soldier who emerged from the customs building and signaled us to pull over. Snow was falling gently, as an officer appeared from the same building, requested our passports, and asked me to open the back of the minivan. We told him that we had just got married, and after he took one look at the cartons of books, crockery, and clothes, motioned with his hand for me to close the tailgate. The snow was now quite heavy, and the officer invited us into the building while he crossed the concourse to the gatehouse. We followed him with our eyes as he picked up the telephone, doubtless checking with Bucharest that my wife's exit visa was valid. Anxious not to reveal any signs of nervousness, we averted our gaze and decided to take advantage of the facilities in the building. After an interval of about half an hour, the officer came back and handed us our passports. Drumbun, Satreits, in other words, safe journey, sir, he said in military parlance, and saluted. As we turned to get in the car, we noticed that some words had been scrawled in the snow that had gathered on the rear window. They read, Casa de Pietra, House of Stone, meaning a sound marriage. We looked at the sentry, who was waiting to escort us to the frontier barrier. He gave us a broad grin. Here was the real face of Romania, a warmth of spirit which rose over the surface of the stony exterior presented by officialdom. There was no envy from this simple soldier, only a display of affection. There is one further incident reflected in my file which I wish to recount for two reasons. First, because it highlights the courage of Corneliu Coposu, the figure here, who after the 1989 revolution, president of the National Peasant Party. And second, the inherent good nature in many Romanians. In August 1986, I took my two young children to Bucharest. I deposited them with their grandparents while I pursued some research into British contacts with Iuliu Maniu, the head of the National Peasant Party during the Second World War. My Romanian friends told me that a key person to talk to on the subject was Coposu, Maniu's personal assistant. I was given his telephone number, but warned at the same time that his house was under surveillance by the Securitate because the poker evenings that Coposu arranged with his septuagenarian friends were regarded as a cover for reviving the National Peasant Party. I telephoned Mr. Coposu, explained briefly who I was, and we agreed a time when I should go to his house. He then warned me that his home was watched, and I said that if he would be kind enough to receive me, then I was unconcerned as to what others might think. As I approached his house on Strada Mamula, number 19, at the appointed time on the 12th of August, I realized that any attempt at disguising my visit was out of the question. The two-story building was one of the only remaining structures still standing in an area which had been leveled in preparation for the construction of Ceausescu's new civic complex. I rang the doorbell and a tall, imposing figure with close-cropped grey hair and a cigarette dangling from the corner of his mouth opened the door. It gave straight onto the demolition zone from which huge bulldozers were scooping earth and bricks and dump trucks were rumbling past. And as I was beckoned in, so too entered an uninvited cloud of dust. The room into which I was ushered was dim, the shutters drawn against the noise and dirt outside, and the only light came from a table lamp with a regulation 40-watt bulb for economy. The presence of a shadowy figure in a corridor from the room leading to a kitchen added to the conspiratorial atmosphere. Mr. Coposu introduced the figure as his sister, who smiled and withdrew into the kitchen. She reappeared some 2 hours later out of the mist produced by Mr. Coposu's chain smoking with a cup of Turkish coffee, which I savoured. There seemed to be, I must say, shadows of Miss Havisham in that room. Coposu, despite his prison ordeal, betrayed no signs of decrepitude or resignation. If any Romanian was the embodiment of the triumph of conscience over coercion, of dignity over debasement, of sincerity over sycophancy, then it was Corneliu Coposu. He offered a paradigm for the fate of opponents of communism. Arrested in July 1947 as a member of the Peasant Party, he spent 17 years in various jails, withstanding beatings and solitary confinement. His memory was remarkable, and in the 3 hours I spent with him, he related details of Manu's clandestine links with the British during the wartime Antonescu dictatorship. He had an appetite for recalling the past, and had I not interrupted our meeting through fear of being considered insensitive by his sister, he would have continued. At my request for a second interview, he readily agreed and proposed a date later that week. When I returned, the first thing he said was that he had been visited by a colonel in the Securitate. This was not unusual, for ever since his release from prison, he had been questioned on a regular basis about his movements and the visitors he received. The colonel had, it seemed, been concerned that Caposo had discussed with me the contemporary situation in Romania, and that I had been used as a messenger by Caposo to seek help for the revival of the peasant party. Caposo warned me that I would be searched on my departure, and that the notes which I had taken, albeit innocuous, should be put in a safe place. Caposo was not the only person to alert me. An official from the Academy of Social and Political Sciences, under whose auspices I conducted the official part of my program, invited me to lunch the day before my departure. He told me that he had been informed about my visits to Caposu and that I had put his institution as a creation of the Communist Party in an embarrassing position. I told him that the visits were private, that I initiated the contact with Caposu, and that since the latter was a pensioner and had no association with the regime, apart from being its victim, I could not see the reason for embarrassment. The attention of the Securitate has been drawn to you and by extension to our institution, since we were expected to inform them of your intentions, he replied. To avoid even greater embarrassment, please make sure that when you leave, you do not have any compromising documents on your person, because we know they will search you at the airport. I thanked him for the warning, and we dropped the subject. I was indeed searched on my departure. After I had checked in my baggage and completed customs with my children, we were stopped at passport control and taken to one side. A militia major politely asked me to go to a corner in the customs hall where a female customs officer was instructed to search our baggage and take any papers she found. The major asked me where our suitcases were, and I told him that they had already been checked in. With a sigh of resignation, he told me to hand my remaining holdall to the customs officer and left. The children asked me in Romanian why we had been singled out for inspection, and this obviously made an impression on the customs officer. She expressed admiration that they, being foreigners, had learned the language, and was even more sympathetic when I told her my wife was from Bucharest. My bag was full of research notes on various subjects, including some on a 19th century Jewish bookseller from Yash, and as she began to finger her way through the handwritten pages, she asked me to choose which material for her to take to the major. I handed over these notes on the bookseller, and off she went. About half an hour later, she returned with them and said we could go. Photocopies of the pages are in my file. It was during this visit, in September 88, my last before the revolution, that Dinescu, whom I had known and translated since 1985, told me at a private party of his problems with the Romanian authorities following a visit he made to the Soviet Union as a guest of the USSR Union of Writers. In an interview with Radio Moscow's Romanian service, broadcast on the 25th of August, 88, Dinescu had given an emphatic expression of support for glasnost and perestroika. Upon his return to Bucharest, he was placed under surveillance and told me that he intended to make a stand against the regime, so publication of his latest manuscript of poems be denied. I promised him that in the event of any measures being taken against him, I would seek to draw attention to them in the British press. In March 89, Dinescu's private feelings about the abuses of the regime were made public in an interview given 3 months earlier at his home in December 1988 to a correspondent of the Parisian daily Libération, in which he attacked the regime's spiritually degrading treatment of its people. interview was published in France on the 17th of March, 1989. On the same day, Dinescu was dismissed from the editorial staff of the writers' union weekly Romania Literară and placed under house arrest. A few days later, a letter of mine highlighting Dinescu's case was published in The Independent. My observations of my autumnal 1988 visit were encapsulated in an article in The Times under the byline "From a Special Correspondent," which appeared on the 8th of October, 88. It did not take the authorities long to work out who the author was, for shortly afterwards, a British friend who returned from Bucharest telephoned me with advice from a Romanian Foreign Ministry official that I should not return. He's number 7 on the list was the ambiguous warning given by the official to my friend, although clearly this was not a reference to Ceausescu's New Year's greeting cards eventually. After more than 20 years of shadow boxing with the Securitate, the prospect of firmer action against me now loomed. I continued to contribute to the BBC World Service, earning the distinction of being declared in December 88 persona non grata. The declaration was transmitted verbally by the Romanian ambassador to the UK, Mr. Stan Soare, to the Foreign and Commonwealth Office, and I was informed of it by the desk officer for Romania. The latter told me that he advised the ambassador to inform me directly, since I was not an employee of the FCO, to which the ambassador allegedly retorted, "Come on now, do you take me for a fool?" The information was confirmed to me in an apologetic manner in January 1989 by the consul at the Romanian embassy when I met him at a reception given by the Hungarian embassy in London, and a brief reference to the declaration of being declared persona non grata is to be found in my file. I thus prepared myself for a long interview of exile from my second home, only to be caught completely off guard by the sequence of events in Timișoara and Bucharest, which led to Ceausescu's overthrow. I was even able to claim a presence in Romania in 1989, for thanks to BBC television, and especially to John Simpson, I was able to return to Bucharest on the 29th of December and to indulge myself, perhaps fancifully, in the idea of a Romania without the Securitate. What is clear to me from a study of my file and gratifying is that some instances of my activity in assisting friends in Romania appear to have escaped the attention of the Securitate. Had they not done so, I would doubtless have been declared persona non grata before December 89, but there are another stories.